Morning, preacher. How you doing? Good morning, Ms. Doobie. Good morning, Deaconess. Hope everybody's doing well this morning. Good morning, Deacon. Good morning, Brother Lawrence. How you doing, brother? Good morning, Miss Vivian. Good morning. Good morning, Miss Tasha. Good morning, Veronica. How are you? Good morning, Miss Monica. Hope everybody's doing well this morning. Good morning, my favorite auntie. Good morning, Miss Aquila. All right. Good morning, babe. All right. Good morning, Miss P. Tell Xavier I said, what's up? All right. Good morning, Miss Yolanda. Good morning, Miss Lauren. Preacher. Miss K, how are you? All right. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Miss Luana. Pray everybody's doing well. Good morning, preacher. Crones Jr. Great message last week. I caught you. Very good message. Pray everybody's doing well this morning. God is good. God is good. Everybody getting on. Good morning, Miss Vanette. Good morning, First Lady. Good morning, Miss Price. Glad you can join us. All right, Miss Brittany. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, cuz. Good morning, Miss Joanna. How are you? Good morning, Miss Brown. Good morning, everybody. Very good. So good. Good morning, preacher. Oh yeah, don't forget to share this video while everybody's still getting on. If you don't mind, share this video so that others can get the word as well. Also, good morning, daughter. Good morning, Elder Rome. Also, if somebody could share this to my page, I would greatly appreciate it. Good morning, Miss Wanda. Praise God. All right. Still getting on. I'm going to give it maybe one more minute, and we'll get to going. Praise God. Good morning, Reverend Flowers. My favorite preacher. Good morning, Octavius. You baby me, and I've been to myself. Good morning, Elder George. How are you? Thank you, Lawrence. I appreciate you, bro. I appreciate you. I have some friends on my page that are not churchy, but they love the word and they listen. They're not on the church's Facebook page, so I appreciate you sharing it to my page. All right. We got a good clip, so when this ends, we're going to get right to it. We're going to pray in and we're going to get right. I'm excited about this message this morning. I'm excited about this message. I believe it speaks to where we are. Praise God. Good morning, Kendrick. How are you, brother? Amen. Amen. All right. Good morning, everybody. I pray that everybody's doing well. I pray that this is a beautiful day. This is the day that the Lord has made, so we will rejoice and be glad in it. Be glad for what he's done, because truly the Lord has done great things. He's done marvelous things. There's no God like our God. He rules and he reigns. He is the God of our salvation. He is the God that sits high and looks low, as some may say. Amen. But he loves me and I love him, and I hope you love him too. And I love all of you. So let's get right to it. Let's go to work this morning. I got a couple of things I want to drop off before we continue on with our day. Praise God. And I heard Michelle Flowers say last night, she was encouraging preachers. She said, I go to church 6 times on Sunday now. I do too. As soon as I get off live, I'll go get on somebody else's live, and I get the word for a couple more hours before I even do anything else. So I really appreciate this platform, this forum that we have, because I can also get the word from someone else. I encourage you to do the same. Good morning, Miss Topsy. I encourage you to do the same thing. If there's not, haven't had the chance to fellowship, this is the perfect time, praise God, to be able to fellowship with others, not just your own local assembly. So let's go to work. I'm going to pray, then I'm going to read the scripture, and we're going to get into this word this morning. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for all that you've done, all that you are yet going to do. We realize that our best days are ahead, Father God. The best is yet to come. So we ask that you continue to strengthen us while we're sheltered in place and waiting for the next move. Help us to receive these instructions, Father God, as you are preparing us for what's next. Father God, I ask you to speak to me even this morning. Clear my heart and my mind of any distractions, any disruptions, anything that will hinder your word, Father. We thank you in advance for what you said. Thank you for the power in your word. Heal, deliver, and set free. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Beloved, I'm going to be reading from the book of John, 2nd chapter. I'm going to read 10 verses of scripture. Familiar passages. I'm sure that you all, most or some of you have read it or heard it or have been taught this in some form or fashion. Don't come to you with anything really new, but I just want to give you what he's given to me. John chapter 2, starting at verse 1. Says, on the third day there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding, and when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. Jesus said to her, woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. Now there were set there 6 water pots of stone according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast. And they took it. And when the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom. And he said to him, every man at the beginning sets out good wine, and when the guests have well drunk, then the inferior. You have kept the good wine until now. I'll say that again. You have kept the good wine until now. This beginning of signs did Jesus in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed him. All right, so we're going to talk this morning from the subject, the best is yet to come. Or if you want another text, he saved the best for last. So that really speaks to what God has done and what God is doing. But to lay a foundation, the Bible says on the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee. A marriage in those days was a ceremony. It was a ceremony that lasted for about a week. And the bridegroom was responsible for serving the people in the chambers and serving the people that came. It was a community event, and it was a party that lasted for about a week celebrating the marriage that was happening. But something happened in verse number 3. It says, when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. So something happened during the feast to where the servants were taking wine out to the people in the feast that they ran out of wine. In a marriage feast, the servants would serve the wine to the guests, but when they ran out of wine, there was nothing else for them to serve them. So the people that were guests of the wedding feast noticed that the wine stopped flowing to them. Today, the wine, beloved, speaks of the anointing of God. That the church used to be so anointed. The church was once so anointed that people could feel the power emanating out of the church. People could feel the power from the people that went to church. That when we went out into the highways and the byways, people understood that there was an anointing, there was a flow of God that resided in us. But somewhere down the line, beloved, we've gotten caught up in an identity crisis, and slowly but surely we have leaked out of the wine that we used to have when we went out to the people. We've forgotten that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation. Now they can feel the emptiness coming out of the church. Now they have noticed that the flow of wine has stopped coming to them. Now they have noticed that the wine that used to reside in us is no longer as effective as it was. Now, in the very next verse, the instructions of the feast, or the instructions to the servant of the feast, was whatever that Jesus tells you to do it. The mother of Jesus realized the time. She realized they ran out of wine. She realized that that day, that particular day and time, was anointed and ordained for God's manifested glory to be revealed. It was time for Jesus, the Messiah, to be introduced to the world. They already knew Jesus, the son of the carpenter. They already knew Jesus, the son of Mary and Joseph, but they needed to know Jesus as the Messiah, as the King and the Lord of all. Likewise today, beloved, they already know the half-baked church. They already know the lukewarm church. They already know the Christians that say one thing and do another. But now it's time for them to be introduced to the remnant church. Now it's time for them to be introduced to the new believers, or the remnant of believers that will carry the wine at all costs. Understand this. There is an all-out attack against the church, because the church, beloved, is a sleeping giant. But God has raised up a people that the very gates of hell would not be able to prevail against them. God has raised up a people that realize that reparations are due. God has raised up a remnant of believers that say it's time to go into the enemy's camp and take back everything that the devil stole from us. Now it's time for the people of God to understand there's a remnant of believers that what grandma shouted about, you're about to walk in. What grandma prayed for, you are the results and the answer to those prayers. Grandma prayed to give you a life. Grandma prayed that the devil wouldn't take you out, but now it's time for the remnant of believers to come from the background to the forefront, understand the times, and know what to do in these times. Let God finish. Let God finish what he started in you. Number two, let God finish what he started in you. God started something in you that was potent, that was powerful, but we've got to let God finish what he started. He that hath begun a good work in us will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Now, because they can feel the emptiness from the church physically, we that are the church ought to be getting filled spiritually. I'll say that again. Now that they can feel the emptiness of the church physically, we that are really the church of God ought to be getting filled spiritually, so that when we go out back into the highways and byways, when they release this order and we are able to go back and socially fellowship with them, they will say something is different about you. You're not the same person that you were when we sheltered in place, and there's something about you that is different. And when they do, you can tell them, beloved, it's the anointing. Now, the anointing had to be redefined, because we gotten used to defining the anointing as some ambiguous term that was negotiated by what people did outwardly, by demonstrative acts and by shaking and quaking and by speaking in tongues or by laying hands. But the anointing, beloved, is an intangible factor that makes you effective for the kingdom of God. God's anointing can't be quantified or qualified. Either you're anointed or you need to be anointed. But the anointing can't be bought. It can't be duplicated. God keeps the enemy at bay by the anointing of God that's in your life. Have you ever wondered why you have made it this far? Have you ever wondered why the car wreck didn't kill you? The heart attack didn't take you out? Why have you ever wondered why you are still here? It's because the anointing of God keeps old death at bay. The anointing of God makes death behave. We've got to get back to seeking God and seeking the anointing anointing and seeking our gifts and seeking what God wants to do, because in this day and time, it's going to take the anointing to destroy the yokes. The anointing does not just sustain. The anointing puts the enemy at bay. The anointing keeps him from being able to rob you of the satiety of victory, peace, healing, and deliverance. We've got to get back to seeking the anointing of God in our life and ask God, show me what is my gift. Show me what is my calling. Show me what it is that you would have for me to do. If there's anointing in my voice, Lord, let me sing until the glory falls. If there's an anointing in my words, Lord, give me the words to speak that when I speak that someone realizes that I've been with you. The anointing of God, beloved, is going to break and destroy. Too long now have we been riding and riding the wave of talent. We allow talent to come in church and duplicate what the anointing looks like. And because someone is talented, we automatically say, oh, they're anointed. But there is a difference between talent and anointing. Talent makes you feel good. The anointing makes you want to change. Talent makes you get goosebumps, but the anointing takes you beyond the goosebumps and causes you to want to do better than what you've done before. We've allowed a slow leak to come into the church to where the talent has come and taken over. But God is saying, I don't care how talented you are. I don't care how many gifts you have, because I gave you the gifts to begin with. Until you allow yourself to suffer and be anointed for that talent, it's just going to be sounding brass and tinkling cymbals. In this new way, in this new work, this new order that we're going in, it's going to take the anointing. We got to sit people down that just have talent, and we've got to wait for the anointing to come. You see, we've got to go back and recalibrate and refocus people that are talented and people that are anointed. People that are talented will only come to church when it's their turn to sing. Will only come to church if they have to play the musical instruments. Will only come to church if it's their program that they're putting on. But people that are anointed will come when it's time to clean the church. Will come when there's nothing going on. Will come and help serve dinners in the community. People that are anointed are not waiting for their time to shine, because anointed people shine even without a microphone in their hand. So we have got to go back to being fruit inspectors and know that it's going to take the anointing of God to destroy yokes in this new day. God told me to tell you that when this is over, he's going to allow the harvest to sample the church. Oh my God, those that are not saved are fruit inspectors. And the reason they haven't come heretofore is because they inspected the fruit and found the fruit had not been ripened yet. But God is maturing a people. God is making the season right. And when they come, they're going to come flooding the church. It's our job to keep them there when they come. But it's only going to be by the anointing of God. My next point. If we were in church, I would tell you to ask your neighbor, what's in your hands? But because we're not in church, you need to ask yourself, what's in my hands? You see, the servant still came out of the chamber to bring it back. They were in the chamber, and the servants went back to the inner court, and they got the wine, and they brought the wine out to the outer court. Oh, I know that's a little deep. But they went in and got the wine and brought the wine out to the guest of the feast, but something happened. They kept going in the inner chamber, but there was no more wine to bring to the outer chamber. We have kept going into the inner chamber, but the wine for the last dispensation has run out. Oh my God. The wine that got us here is no longer valid or effective for what's going to get us there. So they still walked through the crowd, but they had nothing in their hands. We as the body of Christ are walking in the midst of people, but we've got to ask ourselves, what is in my hands? Do we have an anointing in our hands? When we speak, do they listen? When we lay hands, do they recover? When we pray, does it come to pass? When we prophesy, are we on point or are we hitting and missing? It's crucial, because the wine, beloved, speaks of the healing. It speaks of deliverance. It speaks of setting folks free. And the day has changed changed right before our very eyes. The day has changed right before our eyes. Now, I don't know if you understand or realize it, but we are in the midst of creating and forming a new normal. We are not going back to the old tradition of the elders. We are not going back to the way that things used to be. We are not going back to three songs and a sermon. We are not going back to the usher's board holding services. We are not going back to reading the announcements and people getting mad if you missed an announcement. We are not going back to the same order, form, or fashion. There's going to be such power that when we gather together, we are literally going to have our ear to the ground for, Lord, what would you have us to do today? In this day, God has awakened people of purpose. There's a remnant of believers that will push until victory is won. There are some people that actually believe that the fight is not over until I win it. There are some people that actually believe that a loss is not really a loss. It's just a lesson learned. We have to realize this because the battle is not over yet. The battle has just begun. There's a remnant of believers that are putting a demand on the word of God. We haven't even got back to church yet, but I sense in my spirit that there is a higher demand on the word of God. I sense in my spirit that there are people that are hungry, they are thirsty, they are not going to allow the same old stuff to go that has gone before. God has allowed this time to give us time to get ourselves together so that we can feed them fresh manna from heaven, that we can feed them the infallible truth in the word of God. You see, the remnant declares what God said. Then they wait for God to perform what he said. The remnant realizes that decadence does not change the declaration. The remnant realizes that challenges don't change God. Challenges change us. They realize that their commitment to what you declared is imperative after the declaration. There's a remnant that realizes you may block me, but you can't stop me. You may delay me, but you can't deny me. There is a remnant of believer that has an anointing in their hands, and they've got nothing to lose. They're not tied to tradition. They're not tied to the elders. They're not tied to being affirmed. They're not tied to being appreciated. They don't care what people think. They don't care if they endorse or support them. There is a remnant of believers that say, God, I thank you for saving my soul. You brought me out of the depths of hell. I'm glad to know that Calvary has cleansed me from all unrighteousness. I'm glad to know the relevancy of the gospel in this day. I'm glad to know that even if I don't go to church, I am the church. There's a remnant of believers that are about to take this world by storm. God is raising up no names. Oh my God. If you're looking for the next word and the next move of God, it's coming from no names. It's coming from people that have no platform and have no title. It's coming from people that just appreciate who God really is. It's coming from people that don't have to bow down to the status or quo or the creed or the people that have to. There's a remnant of believers that say, if you give me a microphone, I'm going to say what thus saith the Lord. You better be careful how you give me a platform, because I'm not going to condescend, digress. Sin is going to be recalculated and recalibrated to being sin again. No, it's not a situation. No, it's not a circumstance. It's sin. And the wages, okay, I'm trying to keep this in English. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And there is a remnant that will say what God says and don't worry about the repercussions from saying what God says. There is a remnant, beloved. There's a remnant that has something in their hands, and they're waiting for the opportunity. They're waiting for the opportunity to go back out and say what thus saith the Lord. My next point. Are you ready for this change? If you're sitting beside somebody, you need to ask them that. You need a witness real quick. Ask them, are you ready for this change? Are you ready for the change? God told me to tell you that it's time to pull up the net. We've cast the net on this side for years and decades. He said, pull up the net and cast it on this side. Because we've harvested this side. And he says, cast the net on this side. Or in other words, are you ready for the change that's about to take place? There has to be a radical change in the way we display and present and represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to change the way we handle our salvation. We need to change
change the way we conduct business in the house of God. It's crucial because the day has changed right before our very eyes, and God is saying, now come up and see the things that you haven't seen. Come up and hear the things you haven't heard. That there are some things that God has downloaded, but watch this. His downloads does not reach the surface level. That when God downloads instructions to the earth realm, he does not download it on our carnal level. So in order to get the instructions for this next move of God, we've got to come higher. We've got to go higher. We've got to get up to where the instructions are, bring the instructions back down, and bring somebody else up, because God is speaking in this day. He's speaking in this hour, and it's an emergency. Listen, beloved, that the world is in a state of emergency. That the world and the church are both in a state of emergency. There are souls dying in the world. There are souls dying in the church. There are souls dying, and we are in a state. God, the sovereign ruler creator, has declared a state of emergency, to where now we have got to get on our job, because the anointing has stopped flowing to those that are dying and hurting in the world. Without the anointing of God, the world does not stand a chance. Without the anointing of God flowing to them, they won't know how to receive and even come to the Lord. Watch this. There is a high rate of divorce, diabetes, cancer, and all manner of diseases in the world. But the real evidence of the lack of the anointing is there's also a high rate of divorce, cancer, diabetes, and all manner of sickness in the church. Many are weak and sickly among us because we have not discerned the body. So the same thing that's in the world has found its way in the church. The same thing going on in the world, we now find its way in the church. But there is no limit to the manifesting power of God if the believers would just simply pray. There is no limit to the manifestation of the power of God if the people of God would just pray. There is so much going on in the world, too much to declare in one setting, but we have the power and the authority given to us by being ambassadors for the kingdom of God, that an ambassador speaks on behalf of the king of the kingdom. But when ambassadors don't realize their authority and their power, they will say what has been said. But God is saying, you are my ambassador. You have the authority that when you speak, heaven will back it. Earth will have to bow down to it. But we've got to say what thus saith the Lord. There's no amount of demonic activity that can stand against a praying church. But we've got to be ready for the change. The first thing we've got to change is getting back to worship. That we've got to get back to worshiping instead of working. We've gotten too used to just working, and we've gotten away from worshiping, to where the church has full-time employees, but we have part-time worshipers. But we've got to get back to worship being our first and foremost prized commodity. True worship keeps the enemy at bay. That when he would attack you, he runs into your worship. True worship keeps my mind stayed on Jesus. True worship keeps my heart fixed on the presence of God. True worship keeps me in an atmosphere whereby God can abide with me, in me, and work through me. True worship keeps me snapping on people. That when I worship, it calms my nerves. It soothes my doubts and calms my fears. You don't want to know Brother Shy on the outside of a worship lifestyle. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry. So when I worship God, it keeps me from saying those thoughts that try to run and reside in my mind. Worship keeps me slow to speak, slow to anger, helps me to process and speak what thus saith the Lord. Worship keeps me in the right tune. It keeps me in the chambers of God's will. That when you worship God, he allows you to stay what I call the chambers of his will. There's no way you can walk too far outside of the chambers of his will when you are a worshiper. Worshippers are winners. But worshippers have people attached to them, and everybody attached to a worshiper becomes a winner because they're attached to that worshiper. Ain't no way in the world you can be a worshiper, have people attached to you, and they don't feel the overflow from what God did in your life. When God colors your life, God is a sloppy color. color. God cannot stay within the lines when he colors. It's not a fault of God. It's by divine design that when God colors your life, he creates a puddle of that color. That when the people are close to you, they get anointed just by being by the anointed. They feel what God has done with you. I can always tell when I'm in the presence of a worshiper. I can always tell when somebody's been with God, because when they shake my hand or they hug me, I start feeling some kind of way. When they speak, I can sense the anointing and the wisdom in their voice when they speak. So we've got to get back to worshiping God. True worship keeps you from making permanent decisions based on passing dilemmas. True worship keeps you from fainting in the day of chaotic situations. True worship keeps your hope fresh. When you worship God, time is not a factor. When you worship God, you're not worried about whether God comes today, tomorrow, next week, next month, or next year. True worship keeps you humble and it keeps you holy, but it also keeps you hoping. That you get up every morning, today may be the day, but if it's not today, Lord, I thank you anyway. I know sooner or later you're going to show up and show out. Sometimes, beloved, time, trips get long. People start tripping on you because you're on a trip. But that's by divine design that God says you can't take everybody where you're about to go. Oh, I don't know who that's for, but you need to grab that out of the heavens. You can't take everybody to where you're about to go. You think you're losing friends and associates and neighbors and oh, no, God is not stripping you. God is revealing who you can take to this new move with you. Because you can't take complainers to this new move. You can't take gossipers to this new move. You can't take people that only worship in church to this new move. Some people are going to have to sit back and wait and do like Abraham said, me and the lad go yonder to, Isaac said, me and the lad go yonder to worship. When it was time to sacrifice, he realized he couldn't take everybody with him, so he kept them in a place. It was like Jesus when he went to pray in the garden. He left the three there. He said, just watch and pray with me, because where I'm going and this prayer I'm about to pray, everybody can't go. And what you're about to do, everybody can't go with you. Everybody can't flow with you. Everybody can't sit with you. Everybody will go with you to the valley, but how many will walk with you through the valley? God is saying, I'm not stripping you. I'm just revealing who you can take higher with you to this next move. So my next point, we've got to start calling the devil out. And I know that's not going to be popular, but we've got to call the devil out. Stop making excuses for people when they're mean, bitter, and acidic. Oh, that's just the way they were raised. Oh, that's just how she is. Oh, they can't help that. Oh, their daddy was this. Oh, their mama was that. And then we make excuses for people, but we've got to learn, beloved, how to call the devil out. We've got to call sin, sin. We've got to declare what God said, because how else would they know that they're in sin except the saved, sanctified, fire-baptized believer declares that it is sin. Titus 1 and 6 says they profess to know God, but in their works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient unto every good work, reprobate. There are demonic forces that we have got to uncover. There are demonic forces even now, beloved, that are being uncovered by somebody's worship, that are being uncovered by somebody's prayers. We've got to wake up and not just worship, we've got to W-A-R-ship. I know you're good at worshiping, but how good at you how good are you at worshiping? We've got to go to war in our prayers, go to war in our time with God. And somebody is praying for you right now. Somebody has prayed for you. I know you think you made it on your own, but you're standing on grace and mercy right now. You are the results of your grandmama's prayers. You are the results of your grandfather's prayers. You are the results of what your mama declared to God. You are the results of what your daddy declared to God. And you are now, it's time for you to live the life that they prayed that God give you. God answered their prayers. You are the answer to their prayer. So now it's time to get up, get out, and live that life that God said that you can live. It's time to call the devil out of his hiding places so we can go for the head. You see, we've been fighting and giving him body punches, but in order to kill the devil and to get him out of your life, we've got to start going for the head. We've got to go for the head of what's going on. Stop trying to save the land and save the people out of the land. When you start trying to save the people out of the land, it's a blow to demonic activity. It's a blow to the demonic activity sitting over there raging when you stop praying, Lord, save New Bern, Lord, save Havelock. When you say, when you get specific and particular and say, Lord, save my brother, Lord, save my cousin, Lord, save my neighbor, and not just pray that the Lord save them, realize that you are the salvation that they need. Stop sending the Lord to the hospital. Stop sending the Lord to the nursing home. Stop sending the Lord on the highways and byways. Put your shoes on, lace up your boots, grab your Bible, jump in your car, and you'll be the salvation that's needed. God already did what he's going to do, but now he sent us here to call the devil out of his hiding places and go lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. Go preach the gospel and watch people get saved. The world is ripe for revival because it's dying from the inside out. The stage has been set for the greatest move ever to hit this earth. Mm. The stage has been set for the greatest battle ever to hit this earth. Mm. I'm believing God for miracles, signs, and wonders. If I got a witness, somebody type in the comments, miracles, signs, and wonders. I just need to know I got a witness that somebody else besides Reverend Shy is believing God for miracles, signs, and wonders. I'm believing God for miracles to transpire. I'm believing God for signs to come about. I'm believing God for wonders to fall out of heaven on this earth. I'm believing God for miracles, signs, and wonders. Miracles, signs, and wonders. I'm believing God that somebody's going to roll into the church in a wheelchair, and God is going to collectively speak to the body to go up in prayer, and that what they rolled in a wheelchair, that God begins to move in those hands. God begins to move in those legs. God begins to move in those feet. God begins to move, and an authentic miracle, a verified miracle will happen in our local assembly. I decree it, I declare it, I prophesy it to be so, that in our local assemblies, when we are come out of this sheltered in place, that God is going to give bona fide miracles. They're going to call the news reporters down. They're going to call the people to come and see what's going on in these little churches when miracles, signs, and wonders start happening in these churches. God is going to bring those that are sick and weak among us, and we're going to be so prayed up, so filled with the Holy Ghost, that there's going to be authentic miracles, signs, and wonders in our church. God is going to shut church down by these miracles that are going to happen. You ain't going to be able to preach your message. The choir ain't going to be able to sing their song. The glory of God is going to hit so heavy that when that person get out that wheelchair, you're going to have to be the devil himself not to get up and give God praise. When God said, when they come in with the doctor's report and said, they said I had lung cancer, they said I had brain cancer, they said I had diabetes and high blood pressure. But when I went back, they said I didn't have it anymore. There's going to be a glory that hit the church, and the sinners are going to believe. They're not going to believe because you speak in tongues. They're not going to believe because you wear a title. They're not going to believe because you pass around a business card. They're going to believe because they're seeing miracles, signs, and wonders in the church. They're going to believe when we show and prove that God is real, that we stop fraudulating the name of God, that we on trial for fraud, for calling the name but not being able to display any signs. Oh my God, my next point. We've got to resist this new world order. I'm still in the book, but y'all just bear with me. I'm still in the text. We've got to resist the new world order. There has to be a radical change in the way we conduct business in the house of God. You see, God allowed for the wine to run out in the guest chamber because there had to be a change in them just robotically getting the wine, taking it out, getting the wine, taking it out. That where the church has become robotic. Mm. That we get messages and we halfway tell people what we learn, and we halfway, God is saying, no, we got to change this thing. So in order to change the wine, I first got to change the wine skin. I got to update, oh my God, I got to update the wine skins, because old wine skins can't hold new wine. Mm. That this new wine that's coming, the old wine skin can't hold it. So I've got to recalibrate the church and the people that go in the church. Listen to this. It's time to pray more and talk less. Ask yourself, did God really say that? I digress. It's time to give more and take less. You can't complain about the church not doing anything if you're not contributing your time, your finances, or your efforts. It's time to rejoice more and stress less. It should not be stressful to go to church. You should enter into his gates with thanksgiving, come into his courts with a praise, know that the Lord is good, and bless his name. It's mandatory. This move is mandatory because the wine has stopped flowing to the world from the church. And when the wine has stopped flowing to the world from the church, the world is now getting drunk off of another wine. The world is looking for somebody to believe in. You know that we are in trouble if the Surgeon General and Clorox bleach and Lysol have to send out notices for people not to ingest their products. You know people are looking for an answer from any source when they start believing things that don't make any sense at all. You know we're in trouble when people can lie and it be a verified lie, and then everybody says, well, I don't know, I'm still going to believe it. You know we're in trouble when we're depending on a government that is antichrist in nature to help and heal us when healing is supposed to come from the church. There are supposed to be banks that God is setting up in the church. In fact, let me change my vernacular. God is about to set up banks in the church. There's about to be commerce coming out of the church. That church schooling is about to triple and quadruple in this next move. That God is about to bring doctors and lawyers down to the foot of the cross and say, I got healing in my hand as a doctor, but I need Jesus in my heart as a healer. God is about to bring men and women of prestige and prominence in the church, and they're going to give their life to the church. And there is this, it's the equivalent of them getting the wine and taking the wine back out. Because God, if they don't come, God is going to raise up your son. God is going to raise up your, I'm talking to you, he's going to raise up your daughter, he's going to raise up your niece and your nephew, that way when they get out there, they have church in their heart and they have the Lord in their background. They're going to ascribe to be a lawyer, a legislator, a doctor. They're going to ascribe to be someone in the secular system because they were taught to do more than just lift up your hands. They were taught to do more than just dance in church. They were taught to do more than just maintain salvation. They're going to go out to the highways and buy their couple shunna. They're going to go out to the highways and byways, and this next move is going to come from the church infiltrating, going behind enemy lines. They're going to go behind, get the enemy secrets of what the next move is. That way you won't have to depend on someone to tell you what's going on next. They'll bring the word back to the church and say, look, they're doing this and they're doing that. We need to get ourselves prepared and ready. Gird up the loins of the church and get ready, because we've got to resist this new world order. This new world order is full of enticements and has many ways to keep God's people drunk off of her wine. You see, the world is being herded like sheep into a way that's too idealistic and too compromising. Listen to this, beloved. They're microchipping everything from cattle to babies. They are building RFID chips at grocery stores and convenience stores, and they're putting up 5G towers all over the world, and they're setting up this place so that we have one world system, one world market, one world religion, and before you know it, somebody's going to flip the switch. There's going to be a heyday. There's going to be a time where it's going to be mandatory to take a mark. There's going to be a time where it's mandatory to fall in line with what's going on. We're being set up right now for what's going on. We've got to resist this new world order. We've got to resist with all that lies within us. We need some people to teach about this new world order. We need some people to teach that there are RFID chips that they want to implant in your hand. We need somebody to teach that they are creating AI, artificial intelligence, that they are taking away real jobs, giving them to robots. They're putting satellites in the air. They're trying to make humans transhumans, to where we assimilate so much into the system that when the change comes, we won't be able to buy or sell except we have the mark of the beast or the number in his name. So we've got to resist this new world order. We've got to resist because the government is manufacturing maladies, and then they cause us to panic, then they sell us the pill. Oh my God. They cause the panic and then sell the pill because they know a fearful people are a people that can easily be controlled. We're living in a world now to where anything goes. Immoralities turn to normalcy. The enemy has noticed the lack of wine flowing to the church. church. He's noticed that flowing from the church, that we are no longer sending wine from the church to the world. And he notices the lack of anointing, and he started his march toward the doors of the church. Now, let me say this. The devil does not want to close the church. He does not want the church doors to be closed. The devil wants the doors of the church open, but he wants the real church to be closed. Because one day he's going to feign himself to be God or to be God-like. But in order to do that, he's got to defeat the only entity that can defeat him, and that is the church. So he wants us to go to church with our hearts broken and our hearts messed up. He wants leaders to be raised up to the status of leadership, but have not yet been delivered so that they can be good leaders. He loves to see leaders leading while they're bleeding. And we've even popularized that statement, but sooner or later, leaders have got to stop bleeding on people, and we've got to lead them, and we've got to have lives above reproach. No, we're not perfect, but God is calling for the generals to stand up and step up, because the church is not going to close as bad as some people want it to. The doors are not going to close. We've got to go out of the church. There ought to be more ministry outside than there is inside. We ought to cut our programs in half and double our missions and do more outside of the church. But I know we don't need any more choir anniversaries or usher anniversaries or deacon anniversaries or preaching anniversaries. We got enough anniversaries to last. So you can go to anniversary service for the whole 365 days of the year. But we need more mission income of Santa. We need more mission trips. We need more trips to Harlow. We need more trips to Havelock. We need more trips to Craven Terrace. We need more trips to Trent Court. We need more trips to Trent Woods. We need more trips from the guttermost to the uttermost. We need to go tell the rich. We need to go tell the poor. We need to go tell the haves and the have-nots that I know a risen Savior. He's in the world today. His name is Jesus. We ought to go out to the highways and declare and decree that get right or get left, the Lord is coming. These are the last days, that if we don't tell them, they won't know, and they will die out of the will of God, and the blood will be on our hands. Understand that there's an all-out attack against the real church, because the church is a sleeping giant. But God is raising up people to where the very gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it. He's raising up a people to where the very gates of hell won't be able to prevail against you. I'm almost there. I got one more point. But before I get there, he told me to tell you, you are a designated survivor. In the government, they have this protocol called designated survivor. And Google it if you don't believe me. But when there are mass gatherings of the president, vice president, speaker, and chair, and all of these other people of the government, they always call one or two people to be carted off to an undisclosed location, that in the event that there is a mass event to where there are massive casualties, this designated survivor takes over the office of president. That sometimes, especially with these public speeches and State of the Union addresses, you have all of Congress there. But there's always one person. There's always one person that the president chooses himself, and he puts him in an undisclosed location. That if something happens to it, everybody dies, and all the people in leadership, the line of succession dies, this designated survivor takes over. So what does that mean? God told me to tell you that you have been designated a survivor. You have been designated that there's something that has happened in the church to where all of the people are gathering together, but there's something that's happening. There's going to be a switching of the guards to where they're not going to die physically, but God is going to switch the guards to you, because he's got you in an undisclosed location. But now God is saying, come out of hiding. He said, come to the forefront. Your time is now. You were designated to survive for such a time as this, that God is going to make it easy for you. He's going to clear the runway for you. He's going to make the crooked path straight. So now you've got to go, and you've got to get ready for what God is about to do in your life. You see, the designated survivor don't just go to an undisclosed location. He learns about what he needs to do in the event that he has to take over. So there's not a learning curve when he gets on the job. You see, this time where we're sheltered in place, to where the God has allowed this for these designated survivors that's on this line right now. He did it for you. So read your word, eat your word, swallow your word, engulf yourself in prayer. Because when we come out, all of the designated survivors are going to march right into place and say, I know what to do because God showed me what to do. I understand the times and I know what to do. My last point, and I'm going to get out of your way. Understand the times and know what to do. After Jesus told his mother, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour has not yet come. She begins in the very next verse to give instructions to the servants. She said, whatever Jesus tells you to do it. She moved because she realized the time. She heard what Jesus said, but she realized this was the time for him to start showing miracles. She realized this was the time for Jesus, the Messiah, to come to the world. She realized the time and she knew what to do. So watch this. He told them, the servants that went into the inner court, the inner chamber. He said, fill these 6 water pots with water. And he said, fill them to the brim. He told them to fill them to the brim because that's how much work is about to go for. These water pots represent traditional things. Because in Jewish culture, they had water pots set there for the Jews to wash their hands. That they did nothing without washing their hands. So they needed the water pots there. They had always been there, but they had only been used for one purpose. That people are saying that you have only been used for one purpose. You will only be good for one thing. That where you've been is where you're going, but that devil is a lie. Because the remnant church has been hidden in affliction, forced in pain, pushed by rejection, and drawn out by a glimpse of God's glory. These pots had to be stretched to hold the wine because you can't put new wine in old wineskins. Follow me now. See, God had to bring new wineskins because he couldn't put new wine in the wineskins that held the old wine. Oh my God, I hope y'all are hearing what I'm saying. They had wineskins that they brought wine out to the people, but God didn't say fill them. He said get water pots, something totally different, something that people are not used to, something that people may not even receive unless they see glory. So he said get water pots and you fill these water pots with water. And he said, fill them, draw them out, then bear them to the governor of the feast. So God, what God is doing now is filling people with the Holy Ghost. I know we got away from the teaching that you got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. We got away from the teaching you got to tarry for the Holy Ghost. But I'm one that believes that you have got to be filled with the precious Holy Ghost. I believe that you get saved and then you get filled with the Holy Ghost and you get baptized with fire. That God is saying he's filling people with the Holy Ghost. While we're sheltering in place, don't be to thinking that nothing is going on. There's something going on behind closed doors, and God is filling his remnant with the precious oil of the anointing of God. Then after they filled them, he said, draw them out and bear them to the governor of the feast. God is about to draw these filled vessels out. Now, to the world, it don't look like they have any wine. To the world, it don't look like they have any anointing. To the world, it don't look like they have a word in their mouth. To the world, it don't look like they're a prophet of God. To the world, it don't look like that God has given them a spiritual bishopric. To the world, it don't look like they are glory carriers because it's water to them right now. That the world is so used to seeing the wine outwardly that you cannot even quantify what's inwardly. So God is doing this and he's filling people with water and he's bearing them. He's calling us to go out to the governors of the feast, or prominent men and women with the oil of the anointing and the wine and the oil of God. Now, I don't know when the water turned to wine, but if I were to conjecture just for a second, if I were to put myself in the text, That I would say the water turned to wine the moment they took it on the inside. I would say the water turned to wine. You see, the servants had to have faith in God to believe that he did not take them to it, but he was going to bring them through it. So on their way to serving the governor water, they had to believe that God knows more than I know. They had to believe that God has prepared me for such a time as this. So when they gave it to the governor, they had to have faith to believe that It's got to be something wonderful, because what he told me to do didn't make any sense. You know when God is moving when he tells you to do something that doesn't make any sense. So God will fill you, he will draw you out, and then he will bear you to the governor of the feast. And then when the governor took the water or the wine on the inside, it was so good that he called on the bridegroom. It was so good that he had to find out where this wine came from. It was so good that he couldn't keep it to himself. Beloved, God has saved the best for last. He has saved the best for last. God is calling you to get up off the bench. You're third string. God is elevating you to first string. God is now saying it's time for you to get up and bear who you are, because when they see who you are, they're going to say, this God must be real. And he said, you saved the best until now. Most people, they'll serve the good wine first. And then after people have gotten drunk, then they'll serve them whatever, because everything tastes the same after you had a few. Oh, come on, let the church say amen. But most people, when they serve the best stuff first to impress you. And then they serve the bad stuff after you can't taste anymore. But this governor said, most people serve the good stuff at first, but you have saved the best for last. What are you saying? That this move that we are embarking on, the anointing is higher. The elevation is stronger. We are about to see signs, miracles, and wonders. And once they take it on the inside, then they will see that this God is real. Beloved, be encouraged. Just know that your best days are ahead. God has not forgotten his promises for you. He's not forgotten his promises to your children. He's not forgotten his promises. If God said it, he's going to bring it to pass. If he dare declare it, it's going to happen. Take your eyes off of what's going on in the world. Keep your ear to the ground so you can know and disseminate the plans of the enemy. But don't be so inundated with 5G towers and RFID scanners and the president doing this and the cabinet doing that and people dying over here and people. Don't be so inundated, because the news strategically feeds you what they want you to know. Just know that there is something deeper enveloping and developing behind the scenes. But get engrafted, indulge yourself in the word of God. The word of God is the answer, it's the cure to what's going on in the world. You just can't know what's going on in the world and don't know what God said in his word about what's going on in the world. Beloved, God is saying go higher, dig deeper, because there is a remnant of believers, even on this line right now, even on this live stream right now, God is speaking to you. God is speaking to you. Don't let your past define your present so that it will limit your future. He's speaking to you right now that you've got an anointing, you've got a call, you've got a word, you've got a word, you've got a word in your heart, you've got a melody in your spirit. You see, we don't got to wait to go back to church to praise God. We can praise God in our homes. We can declare an end to anxiety in our homes. We can declare an end to poverty in our homes. We can declare an end to depression in our homes. We can declare these things right now. We've got to focus our attention, get filled, because when God draws you out, there's going to be a quick move. It's going to be a quick move. He's speaking to you now, brother. He's speaking to you right now, my sister. He's telling you, do more, go higher, trust. He's saying, trust me. Trust that if I said it, I'm going to bring it to pass. I don't know who that's for, but he's saying, trust me, trust me, trust me. You can't trace God's steps, but you can trust his actions. And God will never tell you to do anything that he's not man enough to make things come to pass in your life. Trust him. Yeah, they're going to talk about you. They're talking about you now. Yeah, they're going to say, who do you think you are? And you ought to tell them who you think you are. Don't tell them who you think you are. Tell them who you know you are. But God is about to do a quick work in you. It's going to surprise even yourself. He's enveloping you and fixing you up right now. He's making you and molding you for his glory. But don't come out on the other side of this fearful and afraid. Stand up, step up. God is about to do his greatest work in you. I don't know who that, I don't know who I'm prophesying to right now. I don't even call myself a prophet. I just love the Lord enough to say what he tells me to say. But there's a strange unction in my spirit. There's a strange, this prophetic edge in my spirit that is telling me to tell you to go higher, to dig deeper, to trust what he said that he would do. Don't worry about what they called you. Don't worry about what they said about you. Don't worry about what you've done and where you've been. God is saying, now is your time. This is your time. Don't let this moment pass you by. The Bible says, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. And somebody on this line today has heard the voice of God. You've heard the voice of God, and he's telling you to do something that you are vacillating back and forth between faith and fear, whether or not you should do what you feel the Lord has told you to do. He's saying, do it. Take it to your pastor. Take it to your leaders. Start praying toward that area that God has anointed you with. Don't let this moment pass you by. Don't let this moment, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. You're not on this live by happenstance. I said all that really to say God is telling you to go higher. There is the oil, the wine of the anointing that God is resting and residing in your belly. And not too many days hence from now, he's going to show you what he said is real. He's going to begin to show you there are visionaries and dreamers that your dreams mean something. The visions you have mean something, but you're afraid to tell anybody because you're not a quote unquote prophet or visionary. God is raising up no names. God is raising up no names. He's telling you go higher, go deeper. If God said it, you say it. Because oh my God, with the virus, they have this thing called flattening the curve to where there aren't any more new ones and there aren't any more old ones. In the church, we have this thing called flattening the curve, or we will, flattening the curve to where everybody's on the same level. The bishop and the apostle are on the same level as the evangelist. The evangelist is on the same level as the layman. The layman is on the same level as that person that prays but has no title, because God is taking titles and washing them to the side. And whosoever will, let them come. Let them come. So be encouraged today. I love you. I'm praying for you. I'm fasting and believing God for a move in your life like none other. I'm not praying for your house. I'm praying for my house as well. So if we pray for one another, God will get the glory. If you don't mind, let's pray before we close. Our most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for what you've said. We thank you for what you've done. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. So, Father God, we ask that you move from house to house and heart to heart. We thank you for this platform that you have allowed us to continue to speak what thus saith the Lord. So we ask you to anoint these airwaves, God. Anoint this time that we have. Speak, heal, deliver, and set free. Let there be testimonies from this time, Father God. Those that may have felt like giving up, they have gotten on someone's live stream and were encouraged. Those that didn't know what they were going to do from day to day, they got on someone's live stream and now have newfound hope and faith and belief. Those that got on the live stream that were not saved, Father God, that they came to a place where they wanted to know you more intimately and deeper, God. Reveal yourself to us in this day. Reveal yourself to us collectively and individually. We thank you in advance for what you said and what you've done. Show yourself strong and mighty on behalf of your people. We will be careful to give your name the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise, because you alone are worthy. Have your way. We bless your name. Thank you for this time we have. We thank you for what you are doing, God. We don't take it for granted. We don't take it lightly. We thank you for filling us with the Holy Ghost and preparing the way and preparing us for what's next. These and other blessings we ask in Jesus' mighty name. And it's in your precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I love you. May heaven smile upon you. And as always, if you want the notes or if you want the talking points, email me or message me or some type of way. Don't put it on this stream because there are so many comments, I will not be able to dig through them and see them. But I just thank God for your time and attention. And if you want the notes, you can just get on my page or something. I'll find a way to get them to you.
God bless you. Tell somebody you love them today. Call, text, email, tell somebody you love them and you're praying for them. I love you, and until next time, shalom.